Hey everybody, in the latest episode of the Azure Enablement Show, I am joined by Brian and Mark, who are going to be talking to me about the new secure methodology inside the cloud adoption framework and security as a whole in your cloud adoption journey. Hey everybody, my name is Sarah Lean and welcome to the Azure Enablement Show. In this show, we're going to be having technical conversations with Microsoft experts, trying to tackle some of the questions or obstacles that you might have along your cloud adoption journey. Now, in previous episodes, we covered off the cloud adoption framework and what it is and how it can help you with your cloud adoption journey. In today's episodes, I am joined by Brian and Mark, who are going to walk me through security and how that fits in with the cloud adoption framework. Thank you both for joining me today.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us, Sarah.
Awesome. Now, my first question is for you, Brian. How does the new secure methodology fit inside the cloud adoption framework?
Yeah, let's start with an understanding of the cloud adoption framework. So we have an easy visual for that. If we think about the cloud adoption framework on this first slide here, we break down the cloud adoption journey into multiple methodologies. And we do that because first off, nobody should ever try to read the whole thing. You'd be bored to tears and fall asleep before you get a few pages in. But when you've got a problem with cloud adoption, these methodologies help you. And we have some for governance and management. We have some around planning and strategy and just adopting the cloud in general. And security comes up in a lot of those. And we'll talk a little bit later about how this fits, but what we've launched now is a new methodology that's similar to govern and manage to help you with those operational questions around security.
Awesome. Now, switching over to Mark. Mark, I know the cloud has changed how we do IT quite fundamentally. If we're thinking about security, how has the cloud actually changed security for us?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, there's two different things that we see that security teams are really wrestling with. One is, you know, the continuing evolution of the threat environment. These attackers are finding new ways to make money, better ways to attack, more efficient ways to attack, or, you know, sometimes they're nation state objectives, but a lot of it is profit driven with the ransomware. And so they're wrestling with this kind of continuing evolution of the attacks. And at the same time, they're wrestling with, hey, the things that we're protecting are being changed out from underneath them as IT goes to the cloud. And they now have to protect, what the heck is an Azure function, right? Like, so they're really trying to wrestle with both of those things at once. And so that's kind of central to the way we were thinking about the secure methodologies. How do we help them, help organizations based on all the lessons learned we've seen, really kind of address that dual challenge?
Awesome. Now, Brian, thinking about this secure methodology and when you were creating it, did you think about what Mark has just told us when you were actually building it out?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, when we build any of these methodologies, they're very customer intensive. So we thought about customers a lot when we built out the secure methodology, and we really structured it around the challenges we see customers go through as they're taking on these new things that Mark's talking about. And to really address them, we had to break it down into a couple of things. First, that thought around business alignment of process and how you get things done, focusing on areas like how do we help the business understand this data involved around risk and get some security insights so that they can make wise decisions. Then how do we help integrate all of the different pieces of security into the best practices, not just of IT, but business behaviors as well, so it can become a real team sport? And then finally, as we're thinking through security, how do we keep focused on that key goal of operational resiliency? So no matter what happens, you're not going to lose the business because of these attacks that come in at you. And if for some reason you do have a compromise, you can recover really quickly and get that full functionality back. So that's the business side. Then we thought, okay, if we're helping the business understand these pieces, how do we get disciplined inside of information technology to really get disciplined at security? And we broke this down into palatable chunks so people can address it a little more easily. And Mark's going to go deep on a number of these, but just going left to right, access control is that great starting point. How do we set up the right access model? Then security operations, that's really that thought of how do we detect, respond, and recover, and how do we make sure that we're watching what's going on and that we're seeing these threats and really treating them with the respect they deserve. And then asset protection is how do we keep those assets safe? How do we really keep that sensitive data and those up and running systems protected from hackers? And then the security governance side is that thought of how do we now continuously monitor, measure, identify, and treat our automations in ways that really respond to those attacks and threats. And then finally, security isn't just a central IT or a cloud center of excellence thing. It's a thing that spans throughout all of technology. So how do we now partner with people on the architecture side and on the workload side and make sure that we're bringing that whole DevSecOps motion to bring together developers, IT operations, and security together to partner together in solutions?
Awesome. Now, Mark, over to you. Thinking about the leadership team inside organizations and how security fits in with there, and maybe some of the conversations people have to have with the leadership teams, how does that all work?
Yeah, that's a great question. The chief challenge that we've seen is that security has been treated for very long as a technical problem. You know, CISOs mm-hmm. typically report to the CIOs. And so it's viewed as a technical problem. You should be able to solve this, you know, problem, solution, map, click, Legos, done. But in fact, it's actually an ongoing risk, and it's a resiliency problem, which is, you know, one of the reasons why we highlighted that business resiliency is you want to prevent as much as you can, but you've got to accept that stuff is going to happen because you've got a human adversary. And so we were really focused on, okay, how do we build a construct around that and the metrics and the culture and the other elements that security teams need, you know, based on some of these leading programs and bright spots that we've seen to help organizations really mature quickly and structure so they can handle those rapid changes from the cloud and from the attackers themselves. So that's really where we focused a lot of our energy on that top part is filling in that that kind of gap that we see a lot.
Awesome. Now, thinking back to what Brian said about access control being the first discipline that organizations often start with, Mark, can you give me a bit more detail about that, please?
Oh, absolutely. The thing that we found about the access control space is many security teams kind of grew out of their networking technology teams, right? And so they're very familiar with a very complex and intricate domain of networking. But they're not necessarily always familiar with identity technologies like Azure Active Directory and Active Directory and whatnot. And so kind of bringing those things together and, you know, picking the best solution for the right environment and getting that was like a huge focus there. It's like, okay, we got to stop with this sort of argument of it's an A, it's a B, it's an A, it's a B. We got to actually get together and have a single coherent strategy, pick the right tech for it, bring the teams together and leverage like zero trust principles is really, you know, kind of that key theme going forward in the access control space. It applies, you know, zero trust is a big applies everywhere kind of theme, but it really becomes apparent when all of a sudden your firewall and network perimeter aren't doing what you wish they did. You know, they're just not enough.
Awesome. Now, I noticed that one of the disciplines is the innovation security discipline, which sounds quite interesting. What does that entail?
Yeah, so that's a great question. As Brian mentioned, you know, there's the business organizations have developer teams and they're like, hey, I need to put out an app to make some money. They get it. They understand the value of tech to their businesses. And so we're seeing really two different kind of things emerging. One is kind of the professional developers moving to a DevOps, DevSecOps type of approach. We're also seeing sort of citizen developers and power apps and some of those elements. So we actually decided to abstract out, have an innovation security of how do you handle this? How do you do this right programmatically? And then have specialties underneath it that focus on things like here's DevSecOps and the controls that make that happen. That's really the way that we approach that space because it's like a microcosm of everything else, just running faster and, you know, at that leading edge. And you want to make sure you're not shipping new things that don't meet current standards. That's a bad situation. You're just creating brownfield legacy you don't want.
Yep. Now, I noticed also one of your disciplines was asset protection. Is that physical asset protection or something else, Mark?
So that's a great question. So we actually triggered and keyed on business assets. And so we know that the business assets do have to translate. So, hey, my, you know, payment systems to make sure that we actually make money. That's going to be multiple IT systems and servers and containers and apps and websites and whatnot. So we keyed on the business assets there as sort of the main focus. And there's a hand-in-hand relationship between asset protection and governance. Governance is making sure you're doing the right thing. And, you know, Brian's going to expand on that in just a moment. But like, you know, the governance kind of tells you what to do, where to do it. And then the asset protection is the execution of those standards on all these, you know, existing assets, you know, endpoints, identities, whatever. But there's also new things coming out because, hey, Azure, AWS came out with this new type of service that we have never seen. We need standards for that. Thank you, governance. But we also need to apply those standards consistently across them. And so we really see those kind of things going hand in hand.
Brian, if I can bring you back into the conversation, because I know you have a great analogy that helps us go deeper on talking about security and governance and the cloud adoption framework. Are you able to share that, please?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. So it can sometimes be confusing for people to think about how security and operations and governance fit together. So I like to think about it like an office building. So if we look at two different types of office buildings, one that's a brand new one that you're building fresh, and one that's been around for a little while, we can start to understand how they fit a little bit better. So in the existing building, it was built a few years ago. It's meeting the business's needs, but decision makers now want to add more compliance, maybe move things around in the environment. Compared to a new building, you get to take advantage of new technology right now. It's an entirely new building. You get to rethink everything. And these give you some different options. So when we're thinking about those different options and we look under the surface of what people are doing in the building, there's a couple of things that are always consistent. There's your security, your governance, your operations management, and a general building design. And they both have these things, but maybe they're a little bit different for a new versus an old building. And when we think about the newer building, we can take advantage of a lot more of that technology and automate things. And maybe there's a little bit less human security because you have more automated tools, a little bit less management because you have automated tools. So maybe governance is a little bit bigger. In more of an existing building, there's a little bit more human effort required for all those things, but they all fit together really well. And so when we start to think about how these fit together, we have to think about what each of those actors are doing. So in security, primary focus is keep out the bad actors, minimize mistakes from the good actors. So people are doing the right things. And to do that, security is expected to bring that security staff. So in a building, that's your security desk and keeping that desk staffed. But they also establish security rules and start to think about guidelines and how do you recover when security is compromised. And they're responsible for leveraging technology to monitor and react quickly. And they can do those things alone for sure. You could have just security and you're going to get really secure. But now when we start to think about really optimized modern security, we have to make it more of a team sport. So on the government side, governance is focused on automation. So can we automate that detection and enforcement? Now we've got self-protecting boundaries. If we think about the management side, can we partner with operations management so that we get even faster recovery when bad actors get in, or better monitoring to watch what people are doing? And then if we integrate with the building design, now we can start to put security strategically in every room and really make it a part of how that business functions. So security shows up in all these. And the same is true for the cloud adoption framework. So we see these same exact functions show up in different places. So for instance, if we look at the earlier stage stuff like planning and readiness and cloud adoption framework, we'll start to see different things around security show up when it comes to the design of the building, or in our case, the development of the Azure landing zone. Or we'll see it show up in the govern methodology because we're automating security things as part of governance. We'll even see it show up in operations management for that recovery. But we have a new methodology that we've just launched inside of the cloud adoption framework, which is really specific to just the needs of security and fulfilling those roles that security needs to. So we see that kind of nucleus of the security decisions there, but then we also see it reflected in all of those other pieces of the cloud adoption framework. You start to see all of the building come together that way. So this is how security fits with a lot of other things that you may be doing and how you can interact with those more together.
Awesome. That definitely explains a lot. Thank you so much for that, Brian. If people want to look more in depth into this secure methodology, where's the best place for them to go?
The best short link is aka.ms/adopt/secure, and that'll bring you right into the Cloud Adoption Framework secure methodology.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you both for joining me today. It's been really informative. And thank you to all of our viewers. And please make sure that you check out our past episode of the Azure Enablement Show and watch out for future episodes as well.